Good evening. Let's stand our feet in the house of the Lord tonight. Father, we love you and we thank you for such a beautiful day. We give you glory and we give you honor and we give you praise in all things, Father. We just ask, Father, that you just make this place a habitation for your glory tonight in the midst of our worship. And we'll give you all the glory and all the praise in Jesus' name. Sing this with me, say, Light of the world, you step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, you're so highly exalted. Glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to this earth you created. All for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am. Altogether loving, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'll never know, and I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never. You're my God. You're altogether loving, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship. Yes, Lord. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to worship you. Oh. And I am standing beneath your wings. And I am resting in your shelter. Your great faithfulness has been my shield. It makes me want to say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And I will bless your holy name for be the name of the Lord. Oh. And I sing praises to to your name, O Lord. For you daily bear my burden. Your great faithfulness has been my shield. And it makes me want to say, blessed be.
He deserves our praise. He deserves our worship. You can't love him enough for all the wonderful things he does for us. Let's just pray tonight. And while we're praying, we have Tony. I don't know Tony's last name, but anyway. No, Glenda's grandson is going tomorrow to have John Kenyon Eye Center to check his eyes. He's losing sight, and he's... in the next while, they talk like, you know, he's not doing very well with his eyesight. So let's pray that when he goes tomorrow, he can get a good report from that. There'll be something that they can do that they haven't found till now. I believe it's your surgery Friday. Is that where you at? Oh, Friday. Is that right? Still Friday? Friday morning. Kidney stones removed, and pray that that'll be successful and will go well. Anyone else here tonight that you have a special need that you'd like for God just to move in? All right, back there for Dustin. Anyone else? Yes, Tom Drake's family. Tom passed away this week. Brooklyn? Okay, pray for Brooklyn tonight. Yes, we're going to be leaving some tomorrow, some Friday, and going over for the installation service with Jeremy, and just pray that everyone has safe travels. Tim is there on their way now. He's got a lot of work to try to get done between now and Friday afternoon, so be praying that he's able to get that work done. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you. Every need that is mentioned here in this building is important. Holy Spirit is here tonight. I feel your presence, God, and I know that you are here. I know, God, that you're interested in every need that's in this building. I know, God, that you're concerned about Tony and his eyesight. And we are praying for him tonight, God, that he'll get back a good report and that his eyesight will begin to improve and It hasn't deteriorated in a long time, but we want improvement. We thank you for that, God, for you are good. God, I thank you tonight for all your benefits, the wonderful benefits of knowing you. We pray for Gleefus tonight, Lord, that you'll let this surgery be successful. God, give us safe trips on our journey. Dustin's need and other needs that are in this building, they're all important, every one of them. When they come from our heart, God, they're important. They mean things. We pray, God, that the Holy Spirit will just reach out to those special needs. Thank you for your benefits. Thank you for the name of Jesus, the name above every name. We love that name, God, and we honor that name. We have come into your house to give you praise and to give you worship, to talk to you, God, about the things that we are in need of, and to thank you, God, for all the wonderful benefits that Calvary's made available for us. Thank you, God, that you've allowed us opportunity and a space to come to the foot of the cross and to just speak our hearts to you. We thank you, God. We thank you that you opened that door of opportunity to us, because there was a moment when we couldn't have done that, but tonight we can. We thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your devotion. For all you do for us, we give you honor. We bless your name tonight in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Give God a praise. Middle school, high school, folks can leave out, go next door. You know, Sunday morning we were talking about that we are living. You can go with them. That's fine. We're living in a time that there's just a lot of people got a lot of hurts, a lot of pains, a lot of people are experiencing a lot of hurts. And there's a need for us to understand that God is there and that God is interested in everything that involves us. There's nothing too small that God isn't interested in it. Everything that involves us, it involves God. Because you're his children. You know, people could do a lot of stuff to you, and you might kind of look over that, might anger you, but you try to look over that, and maybe next week or a few days down the road, you kind of forget it and you go on. But when they hurt your kids, it's a different story. You take on a whole different cloak at that time, because they mean something to you. Well, stop to think about Jesus and us. That same relationship is probably intensified many, many times over in God's attitude and God's feeling toward us. Because no matter how much we love, we can never love with perfect love. But God loved with perfect love. See, perfect love made him love people that he shouldn't have loved. People that we had no reason to receive his love, but he loved us anyway. Isn't that great? Having a problem here tonight. I've got some water right up there in that room. Can somebody grab me a bottle of water? Thank you. She's been hitting the water. She knows where it is. And so tonight, I want to talk about that topic. I want to talk about allowing your pains and the pains you have in life, allowing them to work for you and to make you better instead of destroying you. Thank you. You see, they can do one of two things. They can either build you or they can destroy you. You know that? How many believes that? I know that. And the attitude that you have toward what's going on in your life will propel you toward what the outcome of your life is. And you've got to make those decisions. You've got to make those choices for yourself. No one else can make those things for you. You've got to decide, do I want to overcome or do... See, there's a lot of people that's right here tonight. There's a lot of people all around the world in the building tonight that we might have done things differently in our life if we didn't fear failure. The fear of failure is worse than failure. Living in the fear of that. When God teaches us that fear has torment. Didn't say any particular kind of fear. Just if you have fear, you have torment. There's something tormenting you. And you got to work against that. You can't just accept that. You got to stand against that. You got to fight against that, and you got to believe that God has something better for you. Winston Churchill once said, "Success is not final, and failure is not fatal." Said it's not fatal if you'll take the courage to stand against it, it isn't fatal, and that's true. Failure is not because you make a mistake or because you have a failure doesn't mean you come to the end of the road. There's plenty of people in the Bible that made a lot of mistakes. Do you know that? There's people in the Bible that successful people that we look at and we value and we esteem and we talk about how great they are, but you really, they had some pretty big failures. Yeah, they did. But yet we don't like to think about that. And a lot of times, I've heard people say, "I felt like doing this in church. I just felt like praying for somebody, but I was afraid they wouldn't accept it." Or I felt like going to someone and just putting my hands around their back and praying with them, but I was afraid that they would take it wrong. And you know what? We go home and we're a failure. Because when we fail to do it, it's certainly nothing wrong ever with trying to encourage someone else, right? Nothing wrong with that. And we need to be willing to do that. But let's look at a few folks in the Bible that made some pretty major failures, but made some pretty strong comebacks. Because that's what it's about. It's not about being down. It's about not staying down. See, if you stay down and you're not willing to get up and fight against the opposition that you're in, you're defeated. You're destroyed. But failure is not ultimate and failure is not fatal unless you allow it to be fatal. I've seen folks that maybe because they had a failure, they thought nobody loved them, God didn't love them, the church didn't love them, and there's no way back to God. But that isn't true. If we're willing to make some changes, some alterations, and move forward, God is willing to accept us and allow us to do that. Amen. I look at Moses in the Bible. Moses, I mean, is there a greater man in the Bible than Moses? He wrote the first five books of the Bible. God entrusted him with the authorship of the book of Genesis and even the early chapters of the book of Genesis when he saw by revelation of God the infancy of the earth even before it was formed. He saw when it was nothing but water. Saw it by spirit and revelation from God. And he wrote by revelation from God the story of the book of Genesis. He wasn't there to see all of that. He wasn't there to know that Abraham was a Chaldean, a heathen worshiper. And one day while worshiping the God of water, he was there worshiping the God of water, a pool of water. And while he's worshiping that, the Lord spoke to him. And he said, "Worship the Almighty." He's worshiping a pool of water. And while he's worshiping the pool of water, he comes back later to worship again and finds that the water has evaporated, some of it. So he feels like maybe the water is inferior and he's worshiping the God as an Almighty. And so he begins to worship the God of the sun because he realizes the sun is a dominant force over the water because it has the power to evaporate it. While he's worshiping that God of the sun, all of a sudden he begins to realize there's something maybe more than that because in the afternoon late, the sun begins to go down and hides itself in the night. So he begins to worship the unknown God of the sun. And that's where in Genesis 12, God comes to him and he says to Abraham while he's worshiping the unknown God of the sun, God says, "I am the Almighty. And I'm calling you to come out from among your people, out from among your land, and go to a land that I will send you." Now, Abraham is used by God. And Moses writes all of that story. He wasn't there to see it happen, but he writes all of that story by revelation from God. He writes the story. The amazing thing is, somebody could look at that and say, "Well, maybe it's just a made-up legend then." Well, the amazing thing about that would be is that the story is written over hundreds of years and the prophetical things in the book of Genesis 1:1, Genesis chapter 1, didn't fulfill for 4,000 years later and fulfilled exactly like the Lord said they would fulfill. There would come a seed of the woman that would bruise the head of the serpent. Talking about Jesus coming, who would weaken and break down the power of the sinful nature that man had inherited from the evil one. And it happened just like God had said. All through the book of Genesis, there are prophetical things, like the story with Isaac. is prophetical, speaking of Jesus that is going to come. All through the Bible, there's stories. And Moses writes about those stories. But there comes a moment in time that Moses is called upon. You know, Moses had a rather unusual life. He's born a Hebrew. But as an infant, 3 months old, or around 3 months old, he is taken to live among the Hebrews. And when all Hebrew children are going to be put to death, he's taken to live among the Egyptians. God sends the only woman probably in the entire nation of Egypt that could have saved the life of that Hebrew boy. God sends the daughter of King Pharaoh. When King Pharaoh's daughter comes and she sees him, the Bible said he was fitly to look upon. There was something different. She saw something different in Moses that she had not seen in other children. She raised him for the next 37 years or so. She raised him and taught him the way of the Egyptians. She taught him about every heathen god in Egypt. The Bible said that he was schooled by the best philosophers of Egypt, the most educated men. But there came that time in Moses' life that he had to make a decision for God. See, the amazing thing was when the Egyptian mother takes Moses, she also hires Moses' biological mother to take him and to become the nursemaid for him. So the biological mother has him up until the age of 3. Now there's a reason for that. In biblical times, a child nursed its mother until the age of 3. Pharaoh's daughter had not had a child. She could not be nursed. So she got a Hebrew woman that had been just, had had a baby, and she hired her. So Moses' mother was hired to take care of him. While she's taking care of him, she's putting something in him. And what she's doing, Brother Ferris, every day I think she's reminding him, son, there'll be a day that I'll be taken away from you and you'll be taken away from me. There'll be a time that you're going to be offered the kingship of Egypt. You'll be offered the throne. You'll be offered the wealth. You'll be offered the fame. You'll be offered the power. But Moses, don't ever forget, you were not born an Egyptian. You were born a Hebrew. Now, at the age of 3, he never again walks into his mother's presence. She's taught him from age 0 to age 3. It's amazing. Sometimes people think they're going to start teaching their kids about God when they get up to be 15, 14, 13. Or I'll start teaching about God when I think they can understand. The Bible said train up a child. That means from the very early infancy of their life, start to train them about God. Because the longer you wait, the less opportunity you'll ever have of winning them to God. Moses' mother had him from age 0 to 3 and trained him about God. She put something in him that we call faith. She put the word of God in him. Remember, Moses, don't ever forget who Yahweh is. Don't ever forget who Jehovah is. Don't ever forget that Elohim is God above all gods. Don't ever forget that. The Bible said that Moses was trained for 37 years. And at the age of 40, he is offered the position of the kingship of Egypt. But while he is being offered that by his grandfather, not biological, but his grandfather by adoption, Pharaoh, the position of kingship, the Bible said it came into his heart. What was that it? It was the training that his mother had put in him before the age of 3. Remember what Jesus said? He said, when it's in your heart, when you are called before councils and before men, it shall call to you for testimony. In other words, there is something inside of you, a force of God that is alive and that is real. And when you need it and you don't even remember it's there, the Holy Spirit goes into your mind and the Holy Spirit quickens back what you need. God has the answer. Moses, at the age of 40, could have been the next great Pharaoh, perhaps the greatest Pharaoh that had ever existed. But the Bible said in Hebrews 11, Moses choosing rather to suffer the afflictions with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Whatever came into his mind was a value system that he had to value right then. Do I want the comforts and the pleasures of sin? Or do I want the comforts and the values of God? And he came into his heart and he chose. See, you can't make a choice if you don't have two things to choose from. If I only give you one thing, there's no choice to be made. If you go over tonight to eat and there's only one thing on the table, you have no choice. Or you could not eat, but if you're going to eat, you don't have a choice. You take what's there. But if they give you a variety, in the variety pack, you can choose what you want. Moses choosing rather to suffer afflictions. Choosing rather means that there was a decision for what he could have been versus what he can be. And he chose, I'm going to suffer with the people of God. How many would trade luxury for suffering? How many would trade a tent in the wilderness for the mansion of a king? How many would trade the best horse in Egypt to ride for a new set of leather shoes? Not very many. Moses chose rather to suffer the affliction with the people of God. It wasn't all of Egypt that God came to. It wasn't all of the Hebrew that God came to. But God chose one man by the name of Moses and said to him, go tell the people, I want you on a certain night, on the 14th night of the first month, I want you to prepare by killing a lamb, which meant preparation. You have to find the lamb first. You have to put him up in a corral and examine him daily to be sure he's a perfect lamb. And he said, if a house be too small, then bring another house in and share the lamb. Beautiful message there. When Jesus came to his own, he came to the Jew. But the Jew wasn't big enough as a nation to totally be able to consume the lamb. So when Jesus came, he came for both Jew and Gentile. And we now are a blended family. Amen. They are born of the seed of promise. I'm born of the seed of a heathen. But when I'm born again, all of a sudden, I've yoked up with a promise. And I'm no longer of the old nature. I'm a new nature. I'm a new man in Christ Jesus. I'm full-blooded Jew. Praise God. The blood of Jesus is in me. I've had an infusion. It's been changed, transfused. I have the blood of Jesus now on the inside of me. Moses heard God's commission. Go tell them to prepare. And he told them. They got everything ready. Now this wasn't a little challenge. Israel had 3 million people in their camp. And Moses' job was, you got to tell them all. And here's a man going through there saying, on the 14th day of the first month of the year, we're going to leave here. And if you want to leave with us, you're going to have to kill a lamb. You're going to have to offer a sacrifice for your family. And if your family's too small, there could be nothing of the lamb left. You're going to have to eat the whole lamb. And if you can't eat the whole lamb, you better bring another family in big enough to eat that lamb, because it's all got to go. That lamb was a type of Jesus, the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God was the Word of God, meaning that in the family of God, there could be nothing left. We've got to go by the whole book, not part, the whole book. People sometimes say, well, our church preaches the truth. I'm sure they do. I'm sure there's not a church in town that intends to preach the truth. But do they preach all of it? What do they do when they come to the Holy Ghost, or when they come to tongues, or they come to gifts, or they come to the outpouring of the Spirit, or they come to the Godhead, or any other thing? Are we willing to stand for the truth when other people are walking out? And we know all we have to do is pat them on the back a little bit and they'll stay. I know one thing. I've only got one night to eat the lamb. If I don't get it done today, I'm going to die from not eating the lamb. I've got to eat it all. It's a whole thing. I've got to take it all. The Bible said sometimes it's sweet in the mouth and bitter in the stomach. Sometimes it's not hard. It's not easy to take in. Moses did everything that God told him. And when it came a time for them to leave, the angel of God passed through the land of Egypt, and death hit every family that was not protected by the blood. Death hit them, and the elder son and every family died through all of Egypt. Now think about that. If all of a sudden the elder child in every family in America was gone, we've just come through a big population drop. We've just come through a big change. And that's what happened. All of a sudden, one morning, they wake up and every older son, the oldest son in every family, is laying in the bed dead. That nation is turned upside down. They're confused. They're mixed up. They're wondering, you know, they're calling the EMS and they're calling the funeral directors and they're saying, we can't come because we've got 97 calls ahead of you. You know, you understand where I'm coming from. I had lived that just a little bit, but it's still the same story. Same thing. Every family's hit. So when every family is hoping to have the family next to them to be their help and aid, they can't because they're going through the same grief. And while grief is there, God says to the Hebrew children, time to go, boys. And they start on their journey. They start on their journey, but all of a sudden Pharaoh hears about they have left the land of Goshen and they're headed back to the land of Canaan, and he can't allow that to happen, so he recruits the military and sends them after them. They catch them at the Red Sea. You already know the story there, so I won't spend time there, but in fact, I didn't intend to spend all this time anywhere here. But God said, take the stick and hit the water. Moses, I'm sure he kind of looked at that club a little bit before he thought about that. You know, hey, when you got 3 million people behind you, you got a desert on one side, a mountain on the other side, and an army coming behind you, you're not in a very safe position because you're the guy that led them out. And if you read through there, you'll find out pretty often they were murmuring against Moses. His life was in threat all the way through the wilderness. Every time you turn around, they're trying to kill him. They're conspiring. Somebody's against him. Some false prophet is raised against him. Somebody's doing this. Somebody's doing, and they're going to try their best to destroy him. 40 years he went through that. All right. So he struck the water. The water rolled back. They walked through on dry ground. And when the enemy army got into the middle of the sea, the water just closed up on them and drowned them. I've heard folks say, you've heard that story said that, Some folks said, well, certain times of the year, that water gets real low and you could walk across. Yeah, but you can't walk across on dry ground. And if the water's shallow enough, you can walk across. The amazing thing is how it drowned all those soldiers. You know, that water was deep water. And it covered them up and they couldn't get out. And they drowned in the middle of the sea. So here they go. They're on their way. I would imagine when they come out on the other side, they don't come out on the other side with gloom and doom. The Bible said the very moment that they came up out of that water onto the edge of the water, Miriam grabbed her tambourine. You know, their electric organ wouldn't work about that time. They didn't have a lot of stuff. All they had was a tambourine. Miriam grabbed the tambourine. And she begins to beat that tambourine, and they're dancing and shouting and worshiping all over that riverside. And I would imagine while they're worshiping God, they're praising their leader. Look what our leader has done. He's brought us out. He's recovered us. Wow, God is working with him. He's the greatest leader we've ever had. That was great for a few weeks. Then all of a sudden somebody says, hey, our water supply is gone. Now what are we going to do for water? And all of a sudden they begin to murmur and they begin to say, Moses brought us out. He's brought us in this wilderness to let us die. And Moses goes to God and he said, now God, I'm in kind of a predicament here. I let them out, and they know I let them out. And I've told them that you're going to protect them, and there I have no water, and I don't have any water, and I'm in the middle of a dry, parched desert. What am I going to do? God said, have you noticed that big rock right on the outside edge of the ground that you're camping on? Have you noticed that rock was with you last night when you camped? And it was there the night before? The Bible said in the book of 1 Corinthians 10 that they all did drink that same spiritual drink from that same spiritual rock, and that rock was Christ. And God said, I haven't left you. I'm still here with you. Yeah, Moses says, I understand all that, God, but what's that rock got to do with their thirst? And the Lord said, you know that pole that you just hit that water with a few days ago? Go out there and hit that rock. He went out there and took that pole, hit that rock. When it did, water gushed out. 3 million people drank, washed their clothes, cleaned up, did everything they needed to do, filled up all of their canteens, all of their buckets, everything they had, and they started on the journey. Everything was good for a few days. All of a sudden, they began to think, hey, you know what? There's not much out here to hunt for. We're not getting much to eat. And God said, well, you tell them that when they get up in the morning, I'm going to give them some manna. So they woke up in the morning. Have you ever been hungry in the morning and walked by a bakery? It's just not where you want to go when you're hungry in the morning. And they wake up the next morning and the smell of fresh cooked bread is everywhere. And when they run out of their tents, it's stacked up on the ground, smoking fresh bread, just cooked, rained right out of the heavens. Now, God said, eat yourself full, and tomorrow I'll rain you some more. But he said, listen now, don't you get that bread and try to hold it over till tomorrow. You just trust me, and I'll give you more bread tomorrow. Some of them filled their pockets up with it and filled up their bags, and they thought, just in case God forgets tomorrow, we'll have something to eat. Tomorrow morning when they woke up, run their hand down their pocket, see if that bread was there, they pulled out a handful of worms. God sent worms to eat all the bread up that they had tried to hold on to. You know why? Because the prophecy of that is that God doesn't want a New Testament church to be trying to live today on yesterday's experience. There are folks hoping to go to heaven today on what they received 25, 30, 40, 50 years ago, and they're hoping it's going to get them there. But folks, let me tell you, if God is still giving fresh bread and you're not eating it and giving him thanks for it, you might not be going when Jesus comes back. Amen. Because you might be carrying a pocket full of worms and think you got a pocket full of word. Hello? Anybody with me? Now, I could have preached all night and not said that, couldn't I? But if I had, I wouldn't have told you the truth. Because every day, remember what Jesus said? Those disciples said, Lord, we hear you say all these beautiful prayers, and we don't know just exactly how to do all that. What do you want us to pray? Jesus said, give me this day my daily bread. Not yesterday's bread, my daily bread. I want fresh manna. God, give me a fresh word for today. Well, they got to eating that bread, and all of a sudden, the canteen started going dry again. And God said to Moses, he said, Moses, you know that rock that was outside the camp? Go out there and look, it's still out there. Now, they've been walking now maybe for a week later, maybe a year later, I don't know how long. They've been walking for a long time. And he said, go out there, and that rock's still there. Moses picks up his stick, and God says, no, you don't need a stick. Speak to the rock. You speak to the rock and the same water that was in it before. But listen, let me tell you something. There's a lot of folks that do good in religion for a while, but they're not willing to make transitions. Moses got a hold of a club that would knock a rock in the head and make it produce water, and he knew that worked. But when God said, change your procedure and update it a little bit, we're not going to do that anymore, we're going to speak to the rock, Moses could not trust a change. And he wanted to hold it like it had always been. You got it? It's got to be like it's always been, or just not God. Well, you know what? We had our flyaway day, but I'm not sure our flyaway will just take us where we need to go today. We need a little more than that. Now, that doesn't mean sometimes we may not go back and sing a little of that, but we got to go forward. See, I remember I sat in here the other day, and I was just thinking about back in the late 60s, and I borrowed Harley's old green station wagon and went to Louisville and got air conditioners. What model was that old station wagon, Harley? It was old. Harley, they was working on a school at Brooks Road near Louisville. And I went up to Sears and went to the wholesale part of Sears. Used to have a wholesale and retail, and you could buy wholesale. So I went into the wholesale department and bought those. And Harley's supposed to have been working, but he spotted us going up I-65 and coming down. I don't believe he's working as hard as he let on, like, because all those cars on I-65, and he spotted his station wagon going up down the road. Now, you know what? We don't have to have air conditioning, but I sure like it. We don't have to have a furnace, but I'd hate to cut enough wood to heat this building. I don't want to go back. I want to move forward. I want to propel the church into the next generation, into the next century, the next period of time. And I want them to know that tomorrow's bread may not be today's bread. It'll taste good, but follow your bread for tomorrow. And I want them to know that the way God speaks today, he gave water out of a rock yesterday by hitting it. Now, you know why that happened? Whenever Moses went out there the second time and took that club, God told him, speak to the rock. He didn't do it. He hit the rock. God was kind enough to give him water. But he said, Moses, you just took a part of your inheritance away. You were chosen to lead the people of Israel into the land of Canaan. But because of your disobedience, you can't lead them. You can't take them. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine that? Now, God didn't disfellowship him. Moses went right on and renewed himself and became stronger as a leader in the days before him than he was in the days behind him. He excelled in his leadership. He might have even thought that God had forgotten. Years passed by, and he's still leading the people of Israel. But there's still that disobedience. See, sometimes folks want people to think that if they come back to God, everything's ought to be just fine. It doesn't work that way. It didn't for Moses. It didn't change the fact that he had brought a reproach to the command of God. Now, you know what happened? God used him. God permitted him to do a lot of stuff. But when they finally got to the land, ready to walk right over into the land of Canaan, God took him up to a mountain. Moses doesn't even know, as far as any scriptural indication, he doesn't realize even what's happening. He gets up on top of a mountain, and God said, Moses, you remember that disobedience. And I told you, you can't bring the people of God. Now, you know what? At that moment, here he is in the last minutes of his life. The Bible said that the devil came. The devil came. And right up there on top of that mountain, right on top of that mountain, the Bible said in the book of Jude, only chapter, that there was a contention, a battle went on between the angels and the devil as who's going to get him. And God sent the angels to bear him up. And you know what? In Matthew chapter 17, when transfiguration happened, Brother Ferris, who did they see? Good old Moses did that. He made it to heaven, but he didn't get to do what he wanted to do more than anything else in the entire world. He had forfeited his right to do it. God can still use you, no matter what kind of failure you have made. There might be some consequences, there might be some results, but God can still use you. You've got to let God take hold of your life. Failure gives you a motivating drive to prove yourself and to say, I can. Yes, I made a mistake. Yes, I failed. Yes, I didn't do it right, but I can make it and I will make it. And nobody's going to stop me. Nobody can make me quit. I've started out with God. I've started out with Jesus, and I'm not going to give up until I arrive on the streets of gold. I'm headed that way. I'm going, and nothing is going to stop me. You may fail, but failing is not a failure. The hardest part about failing is getting back up. That's the hardest part, getting back up. Letting your face be seen, showing who you are, what you are, picking yourself back up. We don't accept failure as defeat, but we accept it as an opportunity. Did God want us to fail? No. But it became an opportunity. I will take that and use it as a stepping stone to another state of progressing in the kingdom of God. I can make it. I will step up. I will stand out. I will be stronger tomorrow than I was today. The mistake I made today will not be the history that I will develop tomorrow, but I am going to be stronger because of the God who found me and saved me. Hallelujah. Give him praise in the house tonight. Thank God. Donald Trump said, sometimes by losing the battle, you find the way to win the war. I like that. That's pretty good. Even if it did come from our president. Whether you like him or not, he said a good thing there. Sometimes just losing the battle, it gives you an intestinal fortitude not to lose the war. I'm here to stay. I'm not here to give up. I'm not here to quit. I'm here to move forward. After failures knock you down, you've got to get up and get back on top of the game. You can't fold up your hands and say, I can't go any further. You can't roll up the carpet and say, the battle's over. You got to say, I'm in this to the end. I didn't start to stop. I may have stumbled. I may have fallen, but I'm not in here for a little while. I am here to the end, and I'm going to be here until the end, and I'm going to serve God with all I've got to serve him with. Amen. You know the singer Johnny Cash. You heard about that guy, right? The guy in black. He did make a pretty good statement. He said this. You build on failure. Now, he's a guy that had a lot of failure in his past. He said, you build on failure. You use it as a stepping stone. Choose the door, or close the door on the past. You don't forget the mistakes, but you don't dwell on them. You can't live in them. You can't just keep beating yourself to death with them. Other people have tried to do that. Leave that to them. How many knows that? There'd be plenty of folks trying to beat you to death with anything you've ever done wrong in your entire life. But Jesus said, you don't have to do that. In fact, he said, when I forgave them, I forgave them. That was it. You don't have to. Johnny Cash said, don't dwell on them. You don't let it have any of your energy, any of your time, or any of your space. Don't let your failures determine what your life is going to be. Get up and be about your Father's business. No matter how bad your failure has been, no matter how deep you have stumbled, you may have to relocate, or you may have to move a different distance, but it doesn't matter. Do what you need to do to accomplish the work for the kingdom of God. Amen. It's a matter of saying, I will. I can't quit. I've got to keep going on. Amen. See, I know a pastor. I know a pastor that he never succeeded as a preacher. Never succeeded. And pastored a church in southern Louisiana of about maybe 25 people or so. That's about, I don't mean that that isn't success. That is success, but that's all he'd ever done. About 25, 30 people his whole life. And at the age of, in his 50s, in the age, when he's in his 50s now, that's when, you know, a lot of folks are starting to count down the years to 62 and say, I get to quit. But up in his 50s, he got a call to come and preach at a church in California. And he went. It was a good-sized building. And he said, just a handful of people there, hardly anybody there. And first thing while he's preaching, he looked over into an air conditioning opening, and he said, I saw with my eyes a demonic spirit sitting there. And I looked around that building, and God opened my eyes to see that that place was possessed with demonic forces. Those things are real. Before we built here, we had a church offered to us that was a nice building, nice size building on some ground, and the guy offered, he said, we'll just deed it to you and it's yours. I walked in there and I felt the most cold. I mean, I don't know. I felt demonic forces in there. And so there was a lady that came to the church that I had some confidence in her walk with God. And one night I said to her, I said, ride out with Sheila and me, and I want to show you a church somebody offered. Oh, she said, that's wonderful. They're going to give it to us? Yeah. We rode out there. She walked in that building. She said, I got to get out of here. I can't breathe in this building. There's something in here. There's a force in here. And you know what? I didn't want their building. I didn't want it. I believe in demonic possession, demonic oppression. I believe it is possible. I've seen some of that. Anyway, this guy went there, and he thought he's just going to preach a revival, and they said, we need a preacher at this church. And here they were in a huge building, very few people, 25, 30 people. And he thought, how could you even pay the utility bills here? And they were way behind on everything, if I'm remembering right. You know what? He said God spoke to him to go there and the first thing to attack those demon spirits. And he said he went up and he climbed into those holes and he got up in there and he went to war with those demonic spirits. And over the next, now he's still pastoring that church. He's above 80 now. He's in his 80s. And that church is running about 15 or 16,000 people. Until he's in his 50s, he never succeeded to have a church over about 25 people. If I called his name, many of you would know who I'm talking about. You've seen him on TV preaching. But you wouldn't have seen him before he was about 60 years old because nobody knew who he was. But God had a ministry to open up for him. You can be down and you can have failures, you can have mistakes, but if you will believe God has a place that you may have to move into that place, maybe not, but maybe so, and win yourself a brand new setting, a brand new position, and let God use you. See, because you fail doesn't mean you're a failure. Most people today would have been talking from the time of the event to the time they died about the wickedness of King David when he killed a man to steal his wife, Bathsheba. They would have thought that's the most horrible thing in the world. And it was bad. Okay, it was. Nobody's saying it wasn't. But God restored him into leadership and left him as a king of Israel. And he was one of the greatest kings throughout the duration of his life. But he used that as a motivating factor. Now, he repented of it, sackcloth and ashes, begging God, praying, crying. So, well, when you turn them over to God, then that's the end of them. See, there's a difference when you've been in the kingdom of God and you bring blasphemy to the name of God and then you come back to the kingdom of God. You're not just like a person that's never known God. You understand what I'm saying? It's different. Judgment begins at the house of God. You come under the judgment of when you started your walk with God. God gave David an opportunity. He sent to him Nathan the prophet, and the prophet said this: David, what should happen to a man that if he lived in a house and had a little lamb, he loved that lamb, cared for that lamb, and he lived in a big mansion next door, and he had a whole herd of lambs, and a guest was coming through, and he's going to have to prepare a meal for him. So that guy with the whole herd of lambs decides, I'm going to keep mine. And what I'll do, I'll go next door and kill that guy's prized lamb that he loves so well. And I'll put that lamb to death. So what do you think ought to happen to that guy? Now, if David would have said, I think the man deserves forgiveness and you know, a chance of restitution, that's what he would have gotten. But he said, the man ought to pay fourfold. He never expected the next few words that he was going to hear. David, thou art the man. And in the matter of days, four of David's children died. Horrible deaths. Horrible deaths. He pronounced his own judgment, but God didn't give up on David. And David didn't give up on God. He used his failure, and he said, I was wrong. He never tried to get out of it. He never tried to say, I wasn't wrong. He never tried to do that. He said, I was wrong. I pronounced my own judgment, and as a result of that, God used him as a mighty man. And his future was greater than his past because he accepted the place he was in. When you have a mistake, when you have a failure, don't throw up your hands and quit. Don't do that. There isn't a person in this building, in this church ever, or in this city, county, or nation, or world that can say, I've lived for God and never made a mistake. Because, number one, if they said that, they just lied. So they just made a mistake. They made their first one because they just lied. Because there's not a person that's above some kind of mistake. Amen? Amen. Not a person. Jesus said to Peter, said, hey, guy, you think you're strong. You think you're going to make it. You think everything is going to be all right. Before that rooster gets out there and crows three times, you betray me. Before it happened, no, not me. But did he do it? He not only did it on the third time when they said, I know that guy has been with Jesus. The Bible said he cursed and said, I don't even know the guy. Don't know who you're talking about. And when he heard that rooster, he turned to look. And Jesus turned to look to him. And he knew his mistake was caught. Peter could have thrown up his hands and said, well, there's no need trying anymore. I've let him down three times. I'm sure he's given up on me. I might as well just forget it, go right on and do what I want to do. No. He took hold of that. He repented of what he did. He became the spokesman of the New Testament. He became the foundation for truth. Jesus had said to him, Matthew 16, you're going to go. Whatever door you unlocked with a key to the kingdom of heaven, I'm going to give you that key. Whatever you unlock, it will be unlocked. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. I'm going to give you the key. So, on the day of Pentecost, when they said, men and brethren, what shall we do? Wonder why Matthew didn't preach, or Mark or Luke. Because they couldn't. The door of the church was fixing to open to the Jew. Who was the man that had the key? Peter. He put the key in the lock, turned the lock, opened the door, and Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ." God said, "Whatever you bind on earth, I'll bind it in heaven." Matthew, standing there behind him, approves and said, "Amen, man, that's it. Preach it. Repent, be baptized, every one of you, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, for the promise is unto you and unto your children." Boy, I don't know if he'd have said this next sentence if he'd known what he was saying. But he said, "unto them that are afar off." And Paul later in Ephesians says that those that are far off were the Gentiles. Peter didn't know that he was talking about them. But when the door came from the Jew, who opened the door? Peter. So when it went down to Samaria, Samaritans were not Jews, they were not Gentiles, they were mixed breed. They were biracial. They were half Jew, half Gentile. So, guess who they sent? Here comes Peter and John. Got to have a guy with a key. There's no need going down there without a key. We're not talking to Jews anymore. Puts the door in a lock. And the Bible said when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. And then Peter said, Peter talked to them about that. And he prayed for them. And something happened. I don't know what happened, but I got a good idea what happened. But the Bible said, "For when Simon saw that through the laying on of the hands of the apostles that they received the Holy Ghost, there was some sign that fell." Well, every other time when somebody got the Holy Ghost, the sign was they spoke with tongues as the Spirit of God gave them utterance. So I'm assuming that's what they saw, but they certainly saw something. Amen? They saw it. So then the next time the door's going to open, it's going to open up to the Gentiles. Why don't they send Luke and Andrew down there to do that? Because they can't. Jesus didn't give them the key. So they send the man with a bundle of keys. And the guy with the keys walks in, unlocks the door, said, "Can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, who have received the Holy Ghost the same as us?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Now, after that occasion, we have no further reference of Peter preaching to anybody else about baptism. Over in his epistle, he does mention that this like figure ran to baptism doth now save us. But once he had opened the door for the Jew, the Gentile, and the half-breed, at that point, the door is open to the whole world. Anybody can receive it. Thank God. That means me. Are you glad you can receive it? Whether you've got it or not, you ought to be glad you have opportunity to. Let's give God praise. Father, we love you. We thank you. You're so wonderful. You've blessed us in so many ways. Your kindness. You've given us endurance that we can face oppositions that come against us. No weapon formed against us can prosper. Though the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Holy Ghost will raise up a standard against it. God, because we are not defeated. We're not going to be defeated. We are more than overcomers through you. You've given us the power to overcome. You've given us the power to succeed. You've given us victory through your name. And God, I thank you that I have your name. And I received your name. Ceremonially, I received the glory of your name. And I thank you for it. And I love that name. God, I just thank you for every person's in this building tonight. And for those that are not able to be here and those that are already gone on the trip, keep them safe. We thank you for every blessing you give us. Bless us, Lord, as we thank you and honor you and love you. And we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you tonight. Don't come over next door and let's have a time of fellowship together. And God bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.